Hello students, are you able to see the screen now? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, but actually I converted this PowerPoint into a PDF file. So some of the part of this thing, all font, everything, they change. I put it to convert. This is actually a PowerPoint slide, no? I converted it into a PDF file. So some problem, actually it was neck swellings, clinical triggers. Okay, doesn't matter. But even in neck swelling, previously we were having neck swelling, but the whole neck swelling consists of so many things. So now in this session, I'm going to talk only about thyroid swelling. So before going into the case triggers, I want to show you one diagnostic algorithm. I think I have shared it with you already. So, okay, if it is a neck swelling here, okay, I'll be talking about all neck swellings, not only thyroid, even the non-thyroidal neck swellings also included in the, this is what is called diagnostic algorithm. How to come to a diagnosis if you are encountering a case of, I mean, the neck swelling. So if it is a neck lump, of course, for any case, the first thing you must do is your history and physicals are the symptoms and signs. So you have to get a thorough history and detailed physical examination. Okay, after doing it, okay, you are encountering a midline swelling. Okay, that swelling moves with protrusion of the tongue. So what is your diagnosis? That is a case of thyroglossal cyst. Okay, here they are putting not only midline, it is occupying the whole of the neck, but it is moving only on swallowing or deglutition. That is a case of thyroid swelling. It could be anything. The multinodular goiter, single solitary nodular goiter, a colloid goiter, it could be an adenoma, it could be a carcinoma of the thyroid, but it is a thyroid swelling. Suppose if you are encountering a thyroid swelling, you have to do three things. Number one, thyroid function test. Number two, you have to do an ultrasound. And number three, you should also do a FNAC. So these three things, like your triple assessment in a breast lump, similar to that, here you have to do these three things you must do. Okay. Coming to the swelling in the anterior triangle, if it is multiple, it is a case of lymph nodal enlargement or lymph node swelling. Whenever you are encountering multiple swellings in the neck, most probably this is the lymph node enlargement, that is the commonest swelling in the neck. Okay. Suppose if it is in anterior triangle and it is only a single swelling, not multiple, then you have to look for some special characters. If it is a pulsatile swelling, you have to look for whether it is having expansile pulsation or transmitted pulsation. If it is transmitted pulsation, you are dealing with a case of carotid body tumor. Suppose if it is expansile pulsation, you are dealing with a case of carotid artery aneurysm. Okay, suppose if the swelling appears on sneezing, probably we are dealing with a case of laryngocele. Suppose if the swelling appears on after eating something, yeah, we are dealing a case of pharyngocele or pharyngeal pouch. Okay, suppose if the swelling is in the posterior triangle and it is multiple, again, okay, it is because of lymph node swelling. And suppose if it is having expansile, pulsation, probably we are dealing a case of subclavian artery aneurysm because it is in the posterior triangle. Suppose if the posterior triangle swelling is very soft swelling and it is brilliantly transluminant, okay, we are dealing with a case of cystic hygroma. So these are the things you have to know. And I'm not going to talk about the parotid swelling is not, it doesn't come under the neck swelling. It is a separate swelling, that is parotid swelling also comes under this. Okay, now we will go to the case scenarios. Okay, like the previous weeks, okay, you did very well. I'm actually happy about, because you are coming to the class by in well-prepared manner. You're answering, no? So all of you should answer, yeah, one by one. So now this is a case of, this case number one, this is a 32-year-old man. He is having a lump in the neck. It is a midline swelling. it is moving with deglutition. It is also moving on protrusion of the tongue. Okay, right. Now, what is your diagnosis? Can you tell me? It is moving on deglutition. It is also moving on protrusion of the tongue. So, what is your diagnosis? Hello?
Thyroglossal cyst.
Yeah, okay, good. Thyroglossal cyst. Suppose if it is a thyroid swelling. Okay, thyroid swelling, you know, it moves with deglutition. Okay, what is the reason behind it? Why should a thyroid swelling move on deglutition? Can you explain? Yes. Why should a thyroid swelling move on deglutition or on swallowing? Hello? Why should it move on deglutition, thyroid swelling? Don't know why. Louder, please. I am unable to hear you.
Because it's in front of the esophagus.
Okay, it is situated in front of esophagus. But why should it move with deglutition? Suppose if it is a lipoma, it won't move with deglutition. Lipoma can also occur in the neck. Suppose if it is lipoma, it won't move. Only if it is thyroid or thyroglossal cyst, it can move on deglutition. I am asking you, what is the reason behind it?
It is fixed to the thyroid cartilage.
No. Okay. Indirectly fixed. It is enclosed by what? Okay. I am giving you a clue. Okay. It is something. Pre-tracheal fascia. Very good. Okay. Correct. It is enclosed by pre-tracheal fascia, which is in the posterior aspect that get contents. And it is getting attached to two structures. One is thyroid cartilage. Another one is cricoid cartilage. You can, all of you, if you swallow, you can feel your thyroid cartilage, that is the Adam's apple, that moves on deglutition. So along with this movement, this is just like a hammock. It is enclosing the thyroid gland. Whenever the thyroid cartilage is moving, along with that, the pre-tracheal fascia is also moving up. That will also, the thyroid also is moving along with the pre-tracheal fascia, okay? The posterior part of the pre-tracheal fascia, which is getting thickened and attached to thyroid, and it is also getting attached to the cricoid cartilage. That is called Berry's ligament. Yeah, this also you must know. Okay, right. Now we will go to the, how would you know if this is goiter? Based on the picture, you told me already, because it is, so if it is a thyroid swelling, it should move on deglutition, number one. Just now I explained, because it is enclosed by the pre-tracheal fascia, okay, it is moving with deglutition. Okay, correct, agreed. What are the other structures apart from thyroid that also can move with deglutition? Can you tell me? You may not be, because in my video, it is not there. But I have said, some 9 clinical surgery videos. It is there. The answer is there in that video. Okay, I will answer this question. What are the other swellings apart from the thyroid swelling that moves on deglutition? Okay, what are the other swelling? Okay, it could be thyroglossal cyst. Okay, I told you just now. Apart from that, subhyoid bursitis. That also moves with deglutition. And external carcinoma of the larynx, that also moves with deglutition, and pre-tracheal lymph node, because all these things are enclosed by the pre-tracheal fascia. Okay, this you must know. How can you distinguish a thyroid swelling from the thyroglossal cyst? This I told you already. In thyroglossal cyst, apart from movement on deglutition, this also moves on protrusion of the tongue. Why should a thyroglossal cyst should move on protruding the tongue? Can you explain? Yes. Why should a thyroglossal cyst should move on protruding the tongue? Can you tell me? Hello?
Due to the attachment.
Yeah, attachment, you are correct. Attachment where? Upper part. It is moving on protruding the tongue. So it is attached to where? The thyroglossal duct is attached to the posterior part of the tongue. That is called foramen. Foramen cecum. Okay. The next question is, what is the development of the thyroid? Can you tell me now? If you know that, you can answer this. That is the next question. What is the embryological origin of the thyroid? Okay, can you tell me? Thyroid is developing from,
Neural crest.
No, developing from the pharynx. From the floor of the pharynx. Okay. Yeah, it is coming down as thyroglossal duct. Okay, through that the cells are coming there, and then the thyroid gland will develop. Okay, after development of the thyroid, this thyroglossal duct should get obliterated. Suppose if it is not getting obliterated, okay, the patient will go for thyroglossal cyst. Okay, that is the embryological origin of the thyroid as well as the thyroglossal cyst. Okay, what problems can develop if the lesion is left alone? Suppose even though this thyroglossal cyst is an embryological or congenital problem, usually it won't occur at birth. At birth, day one child, just born, newborn child, that won't manifest the thyroglossal cyst. It will take at least few years, maybe from 8 years to 15 years. That is the commonest age group. Then only it will manifest the thyroglossal cyst. It is a midline swelling. Okay. Suppose if you are not going to do anything, you are not going to give any treatment for this, what are the complications can develop? What problems can develop if lesion is left alone? What will happen to this cyst?
Thyroglossal fistula.
Yeah. How fistula will, before fistula, what will happen to this?
Compression.
Okay. Yeah. It is what complication? It get infected, number one. Okay. It will turn into an abscess. Okay, then it will bust open, that will end up in fistula. Okay, you understand this. So what treatment, suppose if it is thyroglossal cyst, what is the treatment for that? Can you tell me? What treatment you would recommend? Yes.
Surgical excision of the cyst.
Yeah, surgical, what is the name of that surgery? Louder, please. Cyst trunks operation. Yeah, operation. Correct. Very good. Cyst trunks operation. You have to excise. Will you excise only the cyst, or you have to excise two more structures along with the cyst? What are they?
You have to excise the bone.
Part of the hyoid bone, central part of the hyoid bone. Okay. And then what else you have to excise? The whole tract you have to excise. Oh. The thyroglossal tract, no duct, up to the tongue. You have to excise the whole tract up to the tongue. Yeah, that is what is called cyst trunks operation. Number one, you have to excise the whole cyst. Number two, you have to excise the middle part of the body of the hyoid bone, and then you have to excise the whole tract up to the tongue. Why you are excising the hyoid bone also? Why you are excising? It is actually, it is traveling or piercing through the developmentally, the thyroglossal duct is coming through the hyoid bone. If you are not going to remove that part of the hyoid bone, definitely it is going to recur. Okay. So now you are seeing the picture B. What has been performed prior to surgery in picture B? What is this test? For all thyroid surgery, you should do this particular test before surgery, preoperatively. What is this test and what is its importance? Yes?
Thyroidectomy.
No, what is this test I am asking you? What investigation it is?
Laryngoscopy.
Yeah, laryngoscopy, yeah. Yeah, direct laryngoscopy. What is the importance? Why you are doing it? Why should you do preoperatively for all thyroidectomy cases?
To see the vocal cords.
Yeah, to see the vocal cord. whether it is functioning or not functioning, in which injury the vocal cord won't function. Which nerve injury?
Recurrent
laryngeal nerve injury. Okay, very good. Very good. So even before surgery, in which pathology the recurrent laryngeal nerve will be involved? Suppose if it is a case of carcinoma of the thyroid, already your recurrent laryngeal nerve is already damaged, then you are not in fault. After surgery, if patient is unable to speak, they cannot sue you in the court. That is why this has got a very significant medico-legal, importance. You have to prove whether the recurrent laryngeal nerves are already injured or both recurrent laryngeal nerves are intact. That you have to do it. Suppose if it is one-sided injury, one side of the only unilateral injury, what will happen to the patient?
Just hoarseness of the voice.
Hoarseness of the voice, very good. At that particular side, which if it is right-sided, the right-sided vocal cord won't move. It will be in an adducted position. It won't get abducted. Okay, understand? So that will produce hoarseness of the voice. Suppose your patient is having bilateral recurrent laryngeal nerve injury. So now, what will happen to this laryngoscope picture? What will happen to the vocal cord?
They can't
or
get
what? Sense. Yeah?
They correct. Can't get correct. Sense at all.
Yeah, both of them, they cannot get abducted. So both will be in adducted position. So patient cannot even breathe. Breathing difficulty, immediately what you have to do to save your patient? Patient cannot breathe, what you have to do? Bilateral recurrent laryngeal nerve injury already.
And
yeah?
Tracheal intubation or tracheostomy?
Tracheostomy, yeah, very good. Tracheostomy you have to do. Endotracheal intubation you cannot do because these vocal cords are not abducting, no? You cannot put the ET tube inside. You must do, it is not endotracheal intubation. You have to do only tracheostomy because ET tube you cannot introduce inside. See, already both are in the adducted position. Patient cannot even breathe. Air itself cannot come out. Then how will you put the ET tube inside? Through this vocal cord only you have to put the endotracheal tube. We cannot put it inside. So only thing you must do is you should do a tracheostomy. Understand? Okay. We will go to the next case. Okay. This is a 35-year-old man. Okay. It is more common in female. Okay. Let us assume this is a female patient. Okay. Presented with a diffuse thyroid swelling. Okay. Patient is having a smooth, both the lobes are enlarged. Okay. It is not nodular. It's a diffuse thyroid. Both the lobes are enlarged and the patient is also having this eye sign. Okay, now what is your diagnosis? Can you tell me? This is the commonest problem. Yeah?
Graves disease.
Yeah, Graves disease. Okay, Graves disease is otherwise, what is the other name for that? Graves disease.
Goiter.
Goiter, okay. Goiter means enlargement of the thyroid gland, that's all. Even it could be cancer also. Whenever you are dealing with the enlargement of the thyroid, that is called goiter. But what is Graves' disease?
Primary thyrotoxicosis.
Primary thyrotoxicosis.
Yeah, very good. Primary thyrotoxicosis. Okay. Patient also can have diffuse enlargement without toxicity. Yeah. That can occur because of some stress. Maybe because of the menarche, because of pregnancy, or any stress can produce the enlargement of the thyroid. It's very common. So all thyroid pathologies are common in female patients. This you have to remember. Okay? What is your diagnosis? You told me already. What is the definition of this condition also? You told. This is a primary thyrotoxicosis. Okay. Okay, what are the clinical features of this? Suppose if it is primary thyrotoxicosis, what are the clinical features? Can you tell me? Symptoms, and then you can tell me the signs also. What are the symptoms? Number one, there is a diffuse enlargement of the thyroid, number one. Apart from that, the patient is having toxicity also. So what toxicity, what are the characteristic feature of this, the hyperthyroidism or the Graves' disease?
Weight loss despite
eating normally.
Very good. Despite eating very well, in spite of voracious appetite, the patient tends to lose weight. Why they are losing weight? Can you tell me? Why they are losing weight?
Increased BMR.
Basal metabolic.
Very good, very good. Because of increased T4, T3 in the body, patient will undergo increased basal metabolic rate is increased. And that is why they are losing weight, number one. Everything will be exaggerated. Patient will be hyperactive. Okay, they are irritable, they are nervous. Okay, they will be having loose stools. Okay, they will be having a lot of sweating. Everything will be increased except in female patient, they will have oligomenorrhea or amenorrhea. Okay, this is regarding the symptoms. What are the signs you will have? Can you tell me? Of course, you will be having a swelling there. Okay, both the swelling or the goiter as well as the toxicity both occurs simultaneously or synchronously. That is primary thyrotoxicosis. Okay, what are the signs you will get apart from the enlargement in the thyroid? What else you will see? Signs. If you palpate the swelling, what would be the classical surface? Surface of the swelling, this swelling. Yes?
Smooth surface.
Yeah, it is smooth surface. Yeah, smooth. It is not basalated. Suppose if it is nodular goiter, whether it is multinodular or solitary nodule, you will have a basalated surface or nodular surface. Here, the surface is very smooth. Okay, right. Anything else you want to tell in the sign? I told you so many signs, no? In this?
Flammer sign.
Yeah, what sign?
Flammer.
Plumber's sign. What is that plumber's sign? Yeah, tell me. What will happen? Yeah?
It's the weakness of the muscle of the shoulder and top girdle.
Yeah,
and
very good. Weakness of shoulder girdle and pelvic girdle muscle. So, what you will ask the patient to do?
Ask the patient to sit down. And then the patient unable to get up immediately.
They cannot get up immediately. They will take some time to get up from a chair because of weakness of the pelvic girdle muscle. And this is called, Plummer's sign. And if you examine the reflexes, what will happen to the reflex?
Hyper reflex.
In contrast, if it is a hypothyroidism, the patient will have myxedema. Patient will have what is called hyporeflexia. Everything will be decreased. Patient will be very lethargic in hypothyroidism. Whereas in hyperthyroidism, everything very active. And patient also will be having some edematous, skin area in the leg. What is that called? Pre-tibial?
Pre-tibial mixedema.
Okay. And they are also having some eyes. I will come to the eye sign later on. And patient also will have thyroid acropathy. What is that? Apart from this pre-tibial mixedema, they'll be having what else in the... Yeah, they'll be having clubbing of the toes. Yeah, clubbing of the toes also. That is called thyroid acropathy. Okay, now I'm coming to the eye signs. Okay. Some of the examiners, they will ask you, and they you are supposed to know the name of the eye signs. Can you name at least some 3 or 4 eye signs? This is called exophthalmos. Okay. Can you name some eye signs? Can you?
One graphy sign.
Okay. That is lid lag. Okay. Stellwag sign. Good. Yeah, Stellwag. Anything else? Mobius sign, that is convergence. Okay, Geoffroy signs, the loss of wrinkles in the forehead while the patient is looking up. If you are able to tell the proper name, it is good. Suppose if you are unable to remember the proper name, doesn't matter. You have to tell lid lag, infrequent blinking, absence of wrinkling in the forehead. you have to explain what is that sign. That itself you need not mention. If you are remembering the name and if you are going to tell you in the exam, it's okay. Suppose if you forget, doesn't matter. You have to tell what is that sign, that's all. So you have to remember all these signs. This is very important in these things. Okay. How the diagnosis is made? I told you in the beginning itself. Any thyroid swelling, you have to do three things I told you, like the triple assessment in the breast. What are those investigations? Can you tell me? Apart from the clinical exam, yeah?
Thyroid function test.
Okay. Then?
Ultrasound
and FNAC. Okay. Thyroid function test in Graves' disease, what you are expecting? Thyroid function test. If you do, what will happen to T3 and T4?
Increase.
Yeah, both are increased. What will happen to the TSH?
THS
is decreased, whereas the T3 and T4 will be very much increased. Okay, correct. Now, the second investigation you told is ultrasound. Why should you do ultrasound?
To see if it's solid or cystic swelling.
Yeah, very good. You will be knowing whether it is solid or cystic, and you will be knowing whether it is nodular swelling or just generalized hyperplasia. So all these things you can make out by doing an ultrasound. Okay, what is the role of FNAC? Yeah, why you are doing only FNAC? Why not TrueCut biopsy here? Because in breast lump, it is better to do a TrueCut biopsy rather than FNAC. Whereas in thyroid goiter, you must do only FNAC and not TrueCut. Why? Why you shouldn't do TrueCut biopsy in thyroid? Number one, it is very vascular. Good. Number two, so many vital structures are there in the neck. Okay? Lot of nerves are there, important blood vessels are there, carotid artery is there, internal jugular vein is there, so many nerves are there. So you should not, in the breast, if you are going to do it, no vital structures there. That is why you can do TrueCut biopsy in the breast, but not in the thyroid. But in the thyroid pathology, there is one condition where you should do only TrueCut biopsy. What is that?
Follicular carcinoma.
Very good. Follicular adenoma or follicular carcinoma, you cannot differentiate by doing FNAC alone. In that case, okay, you must do a TrueCut biopsy. Very good. Yeah, this is what I want. Okay, what are the different methods of treatment for the Graves' disease? Can you tell me three modes of treatment? What are they?
Antithyroid drug.
Number one, antithyroid drug. Number two?
Radioactive ablation.
Radioactive iodine ablation. Number three?
Surgery.
Okay. Number one, let us talk about the antithyroid drugs. What are the drugs you will give for? What are the antithyroid drugs you know?
Carbimazole
and propylthiouracil. Okay. Carbimazole, okay, you can give. Okay, I'm not going to ask the doses and all. What is the importance of propylthiouracil? You have to give it to which patient? Propylthiouracil. Only
pregnant.
Yeah, very good. You have to give it only to pregnant patients. That you have to remember. That's all. I'm not going to talk about the dosage and all and lot of side effects. Okay, what is the advantage, disadvantage? Advantage is you are preventing all the ill effects or the complications of surgery. But the problem in antithyroid drugs is you have to give it for a long term. You have to give for 6 months, 1 year. Even then, some of the patients, they may not respond. And then finally, you have to do only surgery. Okay? So second method is radioactive ablation. Okay. Radioactive ablation also, you should not give to two category of patients. Who are they? Should not
young
use this
children.
Radioactive young children and
pregnant.
And pregnant woman. Yeah, very good. So why is okay, right? All right. What will you do in this radioactive iodine ablation. So radioactive iodine ablation is iodine what, 123 or 131?
131.
Very good. Okay. Before doing the actual, how will you measure? Pre-procedural, you have to do, you have to inject and you have to find out. And after that, you have to give the actual dose. Actual dose, how will you give? Is it IV or oral? Radioactive ablation dose. Yeah?
IV?
It is oral form. Oral tablets you have to give. But will the thyroid function test will become, normal immediately after the ablation, or will it take some time?
It will take a few weeks.
28 days.
How many weeks?
8 to 12 weeks.
Yeah. You have to wait at least for 3 months. Then only it will come to the normal one. Okay, coming to our treatment, because we are surgeons, no? What is the surgical treatment for, Graves' disease? Now, current treatment. Yeah?
Total thyroidectomy.
Total thyroidectomy. Previously, what we were doing?
Total thyroidectomy.
Previously, when I was a PG, we used to do subtotal thyroidectomy. But nowadays, for all thyroid pathology, we are doing only total thyroidectomy. Unless it is a benign condition confined to one lobe, then we are doing hemithyroidectomy. Otherwise, we are doing only two surgeries. Hemithyroidectomy is also known as lobectomy. Or for all other conditions, we are doing nowadays total thyroidectomy only. Okay. Now you know, but I'm going to ask the complication in the next case. Okay. The next case is, this is our case number 3. This is a 60 years old lady who presented with long-standing neck lump. See, this lady is having multiple nodules. So you know the diagnosis already. There is no toxicity. Okay, what symptom she may be having? This is a chronic, long-standing, because they mentioned it is a long-standing neck lump. So you are seeing multiple nodules. So these patients, long-standing means say 15 years, 20 years. So what is the most probable complaint with which, because no, it is already 10 years, so they may not be bothering about the neck lump, not because of the cosmesis the patient has come to the hospital. Probably what complaint this patient might have come to the hospital. Can you tell me? Long standing, big neck swelling. Okay. Yeah, obstructive symptoms. Yeah, it will be compressing something. So what it will produce, if it is obstructing something in the neck, what are the things can happen? Yes?
Dysphagia,
and now, what now will get affected? Recurrent laryngeal now.
Dysphonia.
All these things can happen. And another important thing in this thing is get below the swelling. Because I am unable to see the lower border. Why you have to look for the lower border in a thyroid swelling? Can you tell me? Yes? Why you have to look for the lower border in any thyroid swelling?
To rule out retrosternal goiter?
Yeah, that's what I am asking you. To rule out retrosternal goiter. Suppose your patient is having retrosternal goiter, what test you will do to confirm it? Clinical test. Yeah? Don't know. Any one of you can answer.
Yes.
That shows that, Pemberton's test. Yeah, Pemberton's test. What you will ask the patient to do? You have to ask the patient to raise both the upper limb. Okay. If it is a retrosternal goiter, that goiter in the retrosternal area will compress the superior vena cava. So what will happen? The face will go for hyperemia, congestion. Okay. If you ask the patient to raise both the upper limb. This is what is called Pemberton's test. This is one method. Otherwise, you can try to feel the lower body with your hand while doing the palpation. Okay, if you are able to feel the lower body, okay, that's it. You are ruling out the retrosternal extension. The another test is percussion. If you percuss right over the sternum, if there is no retrosternal goiter, it should be resonant because of presence of trachea there. Suppose if there is retrosternal goiter there, you will get dull note in the over the sternum if you percuss. So these are the three tests you can do to rule out retrosternal goiter. Okay. You were talking about the pressure effect. If it is constricting the trachea, okay, dyspnea, you were talking about it. What clinical test you will do to demonstrate this pressure effect? What is the name of the test? Can you tell me? It seems that you none of you have watched the video, the clinical surgery video. I've sent some 9 videos, no, not my videos. Clinicals, how to do all the physical, how to examine a thyroid gland. I sent on the first day itself. 9 videos I shared with you. And I ask you to watch these videos as many times as possible. So in that video, okay, please, after this class, please go and watch that video, how to examine a thyroid gland. Because this PBL class is not supposed to demonstration of how to do the physical science and all. Okay? You go and watch how to examine where you have to stand. Whether you have to stand behind the patient or in front of the patient. In front of the patient means what is the name of that procedure. Yeah, all those things you go and watch and learn. Yeah? Okay. This is called caucus test. You have to compress both the lobes with your thumb on one side and all 4 fingers on the other side. You just compress the gland. If patient is having this pressure effect, okay, the patients will go for what is called inspiratory stridor. Okay? This is what is called, that means patient is having compression of the trachea. Okay, this is a long-standing swelling. So most probably the patient will have these pressure effects. Okay, we will go to what clinical maneuver would you perform? That's what I told you just now. Caucus test you have to do. What investigation you would carry out prior to surgery? Okay, that also you told me. The 3 investigations you must do for all goiters. And they did the chest X-ray. Why you are doing chest X-ray for this case? And what is your finding in this chest X-ray? Yeah? Retrosternal you cannot make out. Mm-hmm. What is the importance? Tracheal what?
Displacement.
Tracheal displacement. Where is the trachea? How will you know trachea is displaced? How will you make out the trachea? Can you tell me? Here now you are seeing the trachea there. Yes. Tube. Not
a hollow tube.
Okay, it is a hollow tube, but how will you make out in this X-ray? What is there inside?
The tracheal rings.
Tracheal rings also we cannot see. What is there? Air is there. Are you able to see that block column of air there in the neck of this chest X-ray?
Yes.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Yeah, that is not exactly in the midline. So trachea is displaced to which side? Left side or right side?
Right side.
This is deviated to the right side. What is the importance? Because this will be very helpful for the anesthetist who is going to intubate, who is going to put the ET tube inside. This will be very helpful for them. They will know, okay, probably the trachea is deviated to that side. Okay, they will prepare for all these things. Okay, that is the importance of knowing the tracheal deviation. Okay, what complications might develop after surgery? Suppose, what is the surgery you will do for multinodal goiter? Can you tell me? Yes? What surgery you will do? Yeah. Hello?
Total thyroidectomy.
Yeah, why you are hesitating? How many of you there? 14 of you are there. Only few of you, 2 or 3 of you are answering. So total thyroidectomy, okay. After total thyroidectomy, what are the complications can happen? can happen in thyroidectomy. Can you tell me early complication, late complication? Tension. Yeah, can you tell me?
Tension hematoma.
Yeah, hematoma. Yeah, very good. Immediately tension hematoma. What do you mean by tension hematoma? What do you mean by tension hematoma? What will happen to the patient immediately if you are not going to intervene? What will happen to your patient?
Acute respiratory distress.
Yeah, patient will go for acute respiratory distress. So how will you manage if your patient is going for, I mean, have gone for this tension hematoma? What will you do? Suppose you are the medical officer, you are in duty in the surgical ward. You have been called to see your patient. Patient is in respiratory distress. You are seeing a swelling in the neck. Post-thyroidectomy patient. What will you do? You are suspecting a tension hematoma. What will you do?
Drain it.
How will you? Drain it. You will do it.
We take them back to the OR and...
Yeah. Okay. You have to take the patient to the OR. Okay. And will you do it or you have to call your, your specialist? Yeah. You have to call, you have to inform your specialist. You are not supposed to do surgery because it's a major problem. But if patient is in acute problem, no time for this thing, then you can do anything. You can even do a tracheostomy to save your patient. What they have to do, you have to take the patient to the OT, shouldn't be done in the ward itself. You have to mobilize the patient to the OR, and in OR, under all strict aseptic condition, you have to remove all the stitches, and remove the all blood and blood clots and find out where is the bleeding, and then you have to control it. Yeah, maybe as a MO or house officer, you should not do it. You have to call your specialist or consultant. They only should do it because this is a major problem. Okay, if you are unable to control the thing, then it's a problem. So you have to call them only. Okay, this is how you have to manage. What are the other complications? One is tension hematoma. What are the other complications? Late complication.
Tetany.
Tetany. Okay. That is due to what?
Hypoparathyroidism.
Hypocalcemia. What is the cause for the hypocalcemia?
Hypoparathyroidism.
Accidentally, you removed all parathyroid glands. Okay? Removed all four parathyroid glands along with total thyroidectomy. Okay, your patient will go for the tetany. Okay, they will have the Chausteck sign. You know that Prausia sign and Chausteck sign. How will you manage this tetany or hypocalcemia? Very easy to manage, but how will you manage? You must know. Yeah? What drug you will give? Calcium. This hypocalcemia. Hello? Are you
calcium
sleeping or...
Calcium, you have to give supplements.
Calcium, you have to give IV or oral? Yes? 10% calcium gluconate. You have to give IV. Slowly you have to give. Over 10 minutes. You have to give slowly. Yeah, you can easily manage this problem. What is the other problem? You have removed the whole gland. So patient will go for what? What other problem?
Hypothyroidism.
This, how will you manage this hypothyroidism?
Thyroid supplement,
how long?
2 years.
Lifelong, yeah. Lifelong you have to give. Lifelong you have to give this thyroid supplement. Okay, these are the complications. Okay, while I was talking about this parathyroid injury, suppose while you are doing the surgery, accidentally you removed some structure, but you are suspecting whether it is fat or parathyroid. How will you know that this is parathyroid? If you are able to recognize, even if you accidentally removed it, you have to make sure that is parathyroid only. You put it in a glass of saline. If it sinks, that is parathyroid. If it floats, that is fat. Both are alike, look alike, because it is yellow color stuff. So if it is parathyroid, if it sinks in the saline, you can take it, make slice, like onion slice. You slice it into many things. you can make a pocket in the sternocleidomastoid muscle and you can implant it. These slices there, it will take the blood supply there. Okay, this parathyroid glands will survive. Or you can make a pocket in the forearm muscle and there also you can implant these parathyroid gland slices. Yeah, this is how you can avoid this hypoparathyroidism or the tetany. Okay, now we are going to the next case. Okay, we have this case number 3 is multinodular goiter. Yeah, yes,
sir.
Yeah, yes.
Will there be complication of recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy as well?
Yeah. Because that I have told you already. That's why I didn't ask that one. Okay, I will repeat it. That's an important complication. Yeah. One more complication I forgot. Okay, I will tell you. If it is recurrent laryngeal nerve complication, okay, one side, what will happen to the patient? I mean, what problem will happen? I told you already. Hoarseness of the voice, one side. If it is both sides, what will happen?
Respiratory distress.
Respiratory distress. How will you manage it?
Tracheostomy.
Suppose, okay, right, correct. This is okay. There is another nerve, superior laryngeal nerve, external branch of superior laryngeal nerve. Okay. This now, if you are injuring, what will happen to the patient's voice? What is that complication? Huskiness of the voice. What do you mean by huskiness of the voice? Yeah? What do you mean by huskiness of the voice? You cannot talk in your loud pitch. Say, for example, teachers like me are singers. They have to go to their high pitch, no? Then only I am always speaking in a loud voice. I know that. Because, no, then only it looks like, yeah, good. Okay, I cannot speak like that. That is the problem. If you are going to injure that, this is called huskiness of the voice. Okay, patient also can go for some other minor problems like hypertrophic scar, keloid. All these things can happen in this thyroidectomy. Always it is better to put a drain there. Okay, a suction drain, a negative suction drain, so that even if there is some collection, it will come out. You can avoid the tension hematoma. Tension hematoma will occur only if you are not going to put any drain there. If you're going to put a drain, even if there is some bleeding, it will come out. I always will put a small drain, a suction drain. Okay? Don't be very overconfident. Yeah, actually you need not put if you are very confident, but it is always better to be very humble. Don't think that I am the best surgeon. I will never produce any complication, not like that. Always better to put to be on the safer side. It is what we are going to lose by putting a very small drain. That's not a big drain, very small tube drain. That's also a negative suction drain. Suppose if patient is going to bleed, okay, all the blood will come out. Patient won't go for tension hematoma. Okay, good. Now I am going to the next case. Okay, we have already talked about the multinodular goiter. Here you are seeing a solitary nodular goiter. This is a 30-year-old lady, experienced discomfort in the neck, and she is having a swelling on the left lobe of the thyroid. Okay, this is a solitary nodular goiter. What are the different causes for this solitary nodule? What it could be? Can you tell me a few differential diagnoses for this? Yeah, it could be a goiter. Goiter means what? What is goiter? Hello?
Enlargement.
This could be a thyroid. Suppose patient is having this swelling. When you are asking the patient to swallow, it is not moving. So now what is your diagnosis? Could be a lipoma. It could be a colloid goiter involving one side. It could be adenoma thyroid, one side. Yeah? It could be anything. Yeah, these are the differential diagnoses you have to think of. What examination would you perform next? Ask the patient to swallow. That is the immediately you have to do. If it moves with deglutition, okay, it is thyroid. So why it is moving with deglutition? Can you tell me? Yeah, I told you, no, in the first case.
It's covered with the pretracheal fascia.
Yeah, okay, it is covered with the pretracheal fascia, and that is why it is moving. what investigation you will perform if thyroid lump is confirmed. Yeah, you know the same three investigations, thyroid function test, ultrasound, and FNAC should be done. Okay, but one more important, if it is a solitary nodule or goiter, you have to do one more investigation, very important. Especially if it is a solitary nodule. What is the test?
Radioisotope scan.
Very good. Radioisotope scan. Now the iodine is what? Iodine 131 or 123? Isotope scan.
123.
Yeah, it is 123. Yeah, okay. What is the treatment they have done here in this case? You are seeing some specimen. So what is the... Yeah, thyroidectomy, okay. What type of thyroidectomy?
Hemithyroidectomy
or lobectomy. They have removed the whole this side. Suppose, okay, we have done a FNAC. It came as, okay, we don't know whether it is adenoma or carcinoma. Follicular adenoma or follicular carcinoma, we don't know. They ask you to repeat, but you thought that you will do a surgery. And now you are sending this specimen for frozen section. Now they will tell whether it is malignant or not. If it is malignant, now what else you have to do? You have opened the neck. You did a hemithyroidectomy and you send the specimen to the pathologist for a frozen section. They will tell it whether it is malignant or not within 10 minutes. Suppose if they are telling it is benign, you need not do anything, you can close the neck. Suppose if the finding is, this is a malignant thyroid, okay, that is a follicular carcinoma, what will you do?
You have to remove
the other lobe also. Suppose you are not having frozen section facility, okay, you have sent it to the pathologist and you have closed the neck incision, you have closed and you have discharged the patient also. But meanwhile, the report came as, now it came as, previously they told it is benign. They told not even doubtful, they told it is benign adenoma. Now they are telling it is carcinoma. But you have done only hemithyroidectomy to this patient and you have discharged the patient already. Now what else you have to do in your patient? Patient is coming for the follow-up again. Or you called him immediately because now the report came as carcinoma. You call the patient and what else you have to do now? Still the other lobe is still there. You have to do surgery. You have to remove the other lobe also. This is called completion thyroidectomy. Okay? You have done only hemithyroidectomy thinking that this patient is having a benign tumor. But after biopsy this time, previously they told FNAC, they told it is a benign swelling. Now the same pathologist, now they are telling it is a malignant swelling. It is not our fault. Not the fault of pathologists also. Sometimes it happens. So now what we have to do, we have to call the patient and we have to do, we have to complete the thyroidectomy and this is called completion thyroidectomy. And this also you must remember. Okay, now another case. The patient had previous total thyroidectomy for thyroid cancer. You can see the scar there in the lower part of the neck. So this is recurrence of thyroid cancer. Okay, what you are seeing here in the second picture, this is after treatment for this recurrence. You are seeing two things in this picture. Okay, what are they? This is recurrent carcinoma. Okay, patient presented with hoarseness of the voice. That means already the recurrent laryngeal nerve is damaged. What are the causes? Okay, how will you confirm the diagnosis? You have to take the same three tests you have to do. But I just want to ask you only one thing. What procedure you are seeing here in this picture?
Tracheostomy, sir.
Yeah, very good. Tracheostomy you are seeing, number one. Okay. You are seeing one more tube is also going. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Hello, sir.
Sorry.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So now I'm going again there. It got disconnected. Okay, no problem. Hello, are you able to see now?
Yes, sir.
Hello. Yeah, okay, good. So this is tracheostomy, but apart from the tracheostomy tube, you are seeing one more tube there. What is the tube? It is not going into the trachea, it is going into the esophagus. Can you tell me what is the tube? Feeding tube.
Feeding
tube. You are giving the feedings through that tube. Yeah, this is what you have to do. This patient, there is recurrence, and that recurrence is involving the larynx also. So they did not only the thyroidectomy, they removed laryngectomy also was done in this patient. Okay. And that is why they put a tracheostomy, because laryngectomy was done in this patient. This is a case of recurrence of carcinoma of the thyroid. Okay. This is not a very, I should have put it as a last case. Okay. This investigation also I have discussed already. 23-year-old lady, hyperthyroid, prominent left thyroid nodule. Left thyroid nodule is very prominent. What investigation was performed based on the picture? What is this investigation? Yeah? Yeah, what is this investigation? Yeah, radioactive iodine. Yeah, iodine-123. Why you had to do? I told you in solitary nodule of goiter, you must do this radioisotope scan. Even otherwise, for any case, you can do, doesn't matter. What is the importance? Why it is performed? Here, you are seeing the left nodule is taking the dye more. Dye means this iodine-123. See, compared to the right side, the left side is, the uptake of the isotope is more on the left lobe. Here also, okay, more throughout all four pictures, more dye is taken up by the left lobe. So left lobe is hyperactive. Not hyperactive, it is acting, hyperacting. Okay, why it was performed in a solitary nodule of goiter? What is the importance of, doing this isotope scan? Yes?
So you see the malignant risk?
No. Suppose if it is solitary nodule of goiter, you are doing isotope scan. Three things you have to look. This nodule, whether it is hot nodule, warm nodule, or cold nodule. What do you mean by this? Warm means what? Hot means what? And cold means what? Yes?
Warm means isoactive.
Isoactive. Warm means isoactive. The glands surrounding the nodule also taking up the same amount of the isotope. And this nodule also taking the same amount. This is isoactive. Suppose if the nodule is taking more of the isotope, that is called hyperactive, that is hot nodule. Okay, warm nodule, hot nodule. If the nodule is not taking up any dye, totally inactive, that is called cold nodule. Among the three, hot, warm, and cold, which is dangerous? Yeah?
Cold nodule.
Why? What is the danger?
High risk of
20-30% of these patients, they may go for malignant. They may be harboring malignancy already. So that is the problem. Whenever you are dealing with a cold nodule, you have to be very careful. You have to take a biopsy, or you have to confirm your diagnosis, or you have to exclude malignancy. Okay? Optimized. I think that if the patient underwent surgery, what factors do we have to take into consideration? How can we optimize the results? I think, suppose if any surgery, if patient is in hyperthyroid state, you have to bring them to euthyroid state, and then only you have to operate. This also you must know. Any thyroid surgery, before doing surgery, make sure that your patient is in euthyroid state. But suppose if it is a Graves' disease, patient is toxic, then you should not do surgery. You have to give antithyroid drugs, make them euthyroid, and then only you have to operate. Suppose in hyperthyroid state, if you operate, complication can happen? You are operating not well prepared. Patient is still in hyperthyroid state, but you are operating. What complication can happen? Yes?
Thyroid storm.
Yeah, thyroid storm. Okay. But nowadays, it's very, very rare. If it is going to occur on the table, it's very problematic. So you have to be very, you have to give lot of, too much dose of steroids you have to give. You have to give leucalcitonin, you have to give iopinate. Yeah, that also you have to calcium. Iopinate you have to give, and it is a problem. But nowadays, no, that is why you have to make the patient euthyroid and then only you have to operate. So that is the optimization. And before any thyroid surgery, what investigation you have to do that has got a medical legal implication, I told you in the first case. What investigation you have to do for any thyroid surgery so that you can safeguard yourself from any cases, medical legal cases. What investigation you have to do, what you have to prove?
Yeah, we discussed
indirect laryngoscopy to prove your recurrent laryngeal nerve is still intact. Yeah, correct. Very good. Okay, that is what you have to do. Yeah, correct. Now we are going to the last case. Okay, this is a 80-year-old, but here, not only this case, I'm going to discuss all carcinoma of the thyroid in this case scenario. But here they have shown only one type of carcinoma of the thyroid, 80 years old lady. The age group is important. I will ask you, there are 5 types of carcinoma, you know, I will ask you the age group also. But this lady is 80 years. Had a lump in her neck that moved when she swallowed. So it is a thyroid swelling. What can be seen in the picture? It's a very huge swelling you are seeing, and it is already perforated, and patient is bleeding, actively bleeding. You can see that. Okay. What are the different histological subtypes? So what are the 5 types of carcinoma of the thyroid? Can you tell me? Histological, this is carcinoma. Papillary
carcinoma.
Follicular carcinoma. Yes.
Hertel cell carcinoma.
Medullary carcinoma, Hertel cell carcinoma, and one more. Dangerous.
Anaplastic.
What you are seeing here is anaplastic carcinoma. So if it is papillary carcinoma, okay, what is the age group? Is it common in elderly people or young people? Young people, around 35 years. Okay, it's more common in female patients. 35 years, usually they'll have irradiation for some other problem during their infancy or childhood. So these patients will develop, the papillary type of carcinoma. What are the other characteristic feature of papillary carcinoma? Yes?
Painless
swelling. Whether it is having a capsule or no capsule?
Encapsulated.
No capsule. Okay. Yeah, what are the microscopic feature? 2 things you have to tell me.
Samoma
bodies. Number 1, samoma bodies and orphan?
Orphan anneid
nuclei. So these 2 are very, very characteristic feature of papillary cancer. So this spread by what? Blood spread? Or how it spread?
Lymphatics.
Lymphatic spread. Where it will go? Lymphatics to distant organ, where it will go first? To the neck lymph node. So the lateral part of the cervical lymph node will get enlarged, in papillary cancer. So treatment for all the cancer is the same thing, total thyroidectomy. That doesn't matter. Number 2 is follicular cancer. Follicular cancer, now it is encapsulated. This is unifocal, whereas papillary is multifocal cancer. This is capsulated tumor. But what is the spread for this follicular carcinoma?
Hematogenous.
Hematogenous. The characteristic classical spread is to the skull, the bone in the head, the skull bone, any skull bone, maybe to the frontal bone. And the secondaries will be characteristically, it is pulsatile secondary over the skull. That is the classical thing for the follicular carcinoma. Okay, follicular carcinoma. What is this Hürthel cell carcinoma? This is nothing but a variant of the follicular carcinoma. Yeah, nothing much. Okay, the follicular carcinoma will hematogenous spread. Where it will go? What is the commonest metastasis? Where it will go?
The lungs.
Lungs. Number one, it can go to the lung, it can go to the brain, it can go to the liver, it can go to the bone also. Suppose if it is lung secondaries, how will you pick up? What investigation you can do? Lung secondaries. Yes? Lung secondary,
chest
how will
X-ray?
You pick up?
Chest
X-ray. Chest X-ray. Okay, what is the appearance? Lung secondaries.
Cannonball
appearance, number one. Or you can see malignant pleural effusion. It can present in two things. Yeah. One is cannonball appearance, or okay, you can get malignant pleural effusion. If it is brain secondary, okay, you can go for CT brain. Okay. Suppose if it is liver secondary, what investigation you should do to pick up liver secondaries? Yeah. Yeah. Liver or, okay, any peritoneal secondaries. You have to do CECT. CECT. Okay, contrast enhanced CT you must do. Suppose if it is bone secondaries, how will you pick up?
Radionuclide scanning.
No, wrong. Yes. Radionuclide scanning only. Okay, basics. Yeah, you are correct. Concept is correct. But what is the name of that investigation? Yeah, you are correct. What radionuclide scan, radio isotope you will use for that? You are correct. What radioactive isotope you will use for that? Technetium-99. And this is also known as scintigraphy. After injecting this technetium-99, you have to take the picture with gamma camera. Not with ordinary X-ray. You have to use the gamma camera and you have to take a picture. You can see the bony secondaries. Yeah, all over the bone. And this is called scintigraphy. The investigation is called whole body bone scan. Okay, this is what you have to tell. Whole body bone scan. Okay, how can we monitor for recurrence after? Okay, you did a total thyroidectomy for these cases. So another one, okay. Before going that, I talk about anaplastic is very dangerous. Patient may not live for more than 3 months. Maximum, okay, they can live up to 6 months to 1 year, that's all. They won't live for long. So what you can do only isthmus, you can make a cut in the isthmus so that the pressure effect will get relieved. The dyspnea will get relieved. That's all we can do. You cannot save the patient. Anaplastic carcinoma, you cannot do anything. Okay, the medullary carcinoma, okay, that I didn't talk anything about it. What is medullary carcinoma? Yeah. What is
carcinoma
the characteristic?
Parafollicular cells.
Yeah, okay, parafollicular C cells. Okay, what is the tumor marker for that? Tumor marker, what is secreted by that? Calcitonin. Calcitonin is the tumor marker for medullary carcinoma. Okay, it runs in family. What syndrome is associated with this? It could be sporadic, but some of the cases may run in the family. What MEN syndrome is associated with this? MEN type 2A and type 2B. Okay, whenever you are coming across the medullary thyroid carcinoma, you have to call all other family members also. You have to do screening because this particular cancer, medullary cancer, can run in families in generations. So you have to find out whether anybody in the family is having the same history. I mean, the medullary carcinoma of the thyroid, you have to make up. Yeah, that is regarding the medullary thyroid carcinoma, you must know. Okay, now you did a total thyroidectomy. How will you monitor for recurrence of the disease? What is the tumor marker for recurrence of any thyroid cancer?
Thyroglobulin.
You did a thyroglobulin, very good. So thyroglobulin, okay, you have to measure it. Immediately after surgery, it should be very low. Only if there is thyroid gland in the body, you will get thyroglobulin. If there is no thyroid gland in the body, there won't be any thyroglobulin. Yeah, that is the marker, tumor marker. Suppose after surgery, if the thyroglobulin is, you are getting some, level, thyroglobulin, that means patient is still having thyroid tissue in the body. And it is your duty to find out where is the secondary. Most of the secondaries will happen in the neck itself, but occasionally, okay, 20% of the cases, it can happen elsewhere also. Okay, that also you have to know. What are the primary tumors that will produce secondary carcinoma in the thyroid? Can you tell me? I discussed this in my video already. Which primary tumors will produce secondary deposits in the thyroid gland?
Carcinoma breast.
Melanoma. Melanoma. Okay, good.
Carcinoma of the breast.
Renal cell carcinoma. Okay, good. Okay. You please go and watch the video, how to examine the thyroid gland. Yeah? Okay, I think we have finished this thing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I'm coming.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm coming there.